Dear students, in the last few lectures, we have discussed about principles of friction and one of the applications of friction, namely ladder friction. Now, in this lecture, we are going to see few more applications of friction, namely wedge friction and wheel friction, which is also called as rolling resistance. Now, the contents we are going to cover in this lecture are principles of wedge friction, and we are going to see some of the solved problems on wedge friction. Then the principles of wheel friction, which is also called as rolling resistance, and some problems on wheel friction. Now first let us see what is meant by wedge friction. So now you refer this diagram. So in the diagram you can see this is the wedge and this is the body. And normally these wedges are used for making slight adjustments in the position of a body. For example, tightening fits. So if you want to make some minor adjustments in the position of a body, then these wedges can be used. And in some cases, the wedges are used for lifting heavy weights also. And normally the weights are lifted by applying a horizontal force like this. So if you apply a force like this, so the wedge will move in this direction, so which will make the body to move upwards. And if you see the cross section of a wedge, it is normally triangular in cross section, or sometimes the cross section of the wedge may be trapezoidal also. So if you look at this problem, so you have a body which is resting on an inclined surface like this. So normally the wedge friction problems are treated as problems of equilibrium on inclined planes. So these problems can be solved by two methods basically. One is by equilibrium network and another one by applying Lamy's theorem. Now before solving the problems on wedge friction, so we need to understand the free body diagrams of block and wedge which are involved in the wedge friction. So before drawing the free body diagrams of block and wedge, so we need to understand the basic concepts of friction, so which we have seen in the previous lecture. So we have seen about the angle of friction. So let us refresh again. So now this is a block which is resting on a horizontal surface. So you have the self weight of the block, you have the applied force P. So this will be the direction of the motion. And you have the normal reaction which is developed at the contact surface, N. And F is the frictional force which is acting opposite to the direction of the motion. Now this is the free body diagram where all the forces are marked in. So you can see the self weight of the body, you can see the normal reaction, and you can see the frictional force. So this R is nothing but the resultant force of the frictional force F and the normal reaction N. So this phi is nothing but the angle which the resultant makes with the normal reaction. So this phi is called as angle of friction. Now coming to the free body diagram of a block as well as wedge. Now you can see this is the block and this is the wedge. So now in the wedge we have the applied force P. So now let us start with the free body diagram of the wedge first. So the wedge is nothing but ABC. So you have the applied force P which is marked here. So because of this applied force, your frictional force will be acting in a direction opposite to the applied force direction. Therefore, your frictional force will be acting in this direction. Similarly, in the surface that is AB, also the frictional force will be acting opposite to the direction of the motion. Therefore, the frictional force will be from A to B. Now, the reactions R2 and R3 which are shown here are nothing but the resultant reaction between the frictional force and the normal reaction. So, the one which is shown in the pink color dotted lines is nothing but the normal reaction. Now, you can see in the surface AC, you have the normal reaction N3 which is acting perpendicular to the surface of contact. Similarly, in the surface AB, you can see the normal reaction which is nothing but N2 which is acting perpendicular to the surface of the contact, that is AB. So this is the free body diagram of the wedge. Now coming to the free body diagram of the block. So W which is marked here is nothing but the self weight of the block, and this surface AB is similar to or is nothing but the surface AB which is shown here. Now here you can see the normal reaction between the wall and the block. So the normal reaction again is shown in pink color dotted lines here as well as here. So this is the normal reaction N1, and this R1 is nothing but the resultant of the normal reaction N1 and the frictional force which is acting in between the wall and the block. And here, since you have the applied force acting like this, it will make the block move upwards. Therefore, the frictional force will be acting downwards like this. So, F1 will be acting in the downward direction. Now, coming to the surface, the horizontal surface AB. Now, here the frictional force in the case of wedge is acting in this direction from A to B. Therefore, from here, in the case of the block, the frictional force at this contact surface AB will be acting from B to A. Because at this surface, both the frictional forces will be equal and opposite. Therefore, here the frictional force will be acting in a direction from A to B. Whereas in the case of a block, at the contact surface AB, the frictional force F2 will be acting in a direction from B to A. Now, this R2 is nothing but the resultant reaction of N2 and F2. So, this is the free body diagram. Now, with this background, let us see the problem number 1 on wedge friction. So, the problem number 1 is you have a block weighing 1500 Newton overlying a 10 degree wedge on a horizontal floor and leaning against a vertical wall is to be raised by applying a horizontal force to the wedge. Assuming the coefficient of friction between all the surface in contact to be 0.3, determine the minimum horizontal force required to raise the block. So this is the problem. So you have a block, the weight of the block is 1500 Newton and it is lying on a horizontal floor against a vertical wall. So it is leaning against a vertical wall like this, and here the angle of the wedge is 10 degrees, which is given, and the coefficient of friction between all the surfaces is given as 0.3. That means that the coefficient of friction between the wall and the block, similarly the coefficient of friction between the block and the wedge, so all are given as 0.3. So you have to get the value of force, that is the minimum value of horizontal force required in order to raise the block. So this is the question. So since here the coefficient of friction is given as 0.3, so we know that the coefficient of friction is nothing but tan phi, which is nothing but F by N. So the coefficient of friction is nothing but the ratio between the frictional force and the normal reaction, so which we have seen in the previous lectures, so which is nothing but tan phi, and from this we're getting the value of phi as 16.7 degrees. So now if you look at this diagram, so you have the applied force P, and we have to get this applied force P, and you have the self weight of the block which is marked here 1500 Newton, and the other forces which are acting here are, so you have the normal reaction here N1, then you have R1 which is nothing but the resultant of N1 and the frictional force acting here, and similarly here you have the normal reaction N2, and this R2 is nothing but the resultant of the normal reaction N2 and the frictional force which is acting here, and similarly you have the normal reaction N3, and this R3 is nothing but the resultant of the normal reaction N3 and the frictional force F3. So these are the forces which are acting in this system. Now let us see about the free body diagrams of each component separately. Now let us first see the free body diagram of the block. So here we can see the forces acting in the block. You have the self weight of 1500 Newton and you have the reaction R1, so which is nothing but which is produced because of this N1 and F1. So as you know, since you have a force here which is going to make the block move upwards, your frictional force here is acting in the downward direction. Therefore, the frictional force between the wall and the block is acting in the downward direction, which is shown like this. Then, coming to the contact surface here, that is in AB, along AB, so you have a normal reaction N2, which is shown in pink dotted lines, and you have the frictional force F2, which is acting in this direction, because in the case of wedge, if you have applied force like this, along the line AB, the frictional force will be acting in this direction if you consider the wedge alone. But if you consider the block, the frictional force will be acting in this direction because at this juncture or at this contact surface, both the frictional forces will be equal and opposite. So that's why when you consider the free body diagram of the block, the frictional force F2 will be acting from B to A. Whereas in the case of wedge, if you take the surface AB, the frictional force will be acting from A to B. So you have to understand the difference here. So now here N2, which is shown in pink color dotted line, is the normal reaction, and F2 is the frictional force, and the resultant of these two forces, that is N2 and F2, is shown here, that is R2. Now from the geometry, so these are the forces acting on this block, that is you have 1500 newton, then you have the reaction R1, which is the resultant of N1 and F1, then you have the reaction R2, which is the resultant of N2 and F2. So now we are going to resolve the forces horizontally as well as vertically. So when you resolve the forces horizontally, so you have to resolve this R1. So R1 is the resultant reaction. So R1 cos phi. So already we know that tan phi is equal to 0.3. From that phi we got 16.7 degree. So R1 cos phi. So R1 cos 16.7 degrees. Now coming to this R2. So now let us take the geometry. So now at this point I'm drawing a horizontal line and I'm drawing a vertical line. Now since this angle is 10 degree, so this angle will also be equal to 10 degree. And now since this and this are perpendicular to each other, so this is 10 degree. So this angle will be equal to 80 degree. Because the normal reaction is acting perpendicular to the surface. So now since this is 10 degree, this will be equal to 80 degree. Since the angle between this pink color dotted line and the surface AB will be equal to 90 degree. So this is 10 degree and this will be 80 degree. Now since this line and this line are perpendicular to each other, since this is 80, so this is going to be 10. Now the angle between the resultant reaction R2 and this vertical line is 5 plus 10 degrees. So that is this angle. That is, we are resolving this force R2 horizontally. So when you resolve this force R2 horizontally, you get R2 sine 10 plus 16.7 degree. So which is equal to R2 sine 26.7 degrees. So from this, we are getting an equation or a relationship between R1 and R2 like this. Now similarly, resolving the forces vertically, so if you resolve the forces vertically, so you have R1 sine 5 and you have a vertical force 1500, so plus 1500 is equal to, similarly, if you resolve this force R2 in the vertical direction, so you will be getting cos 10 plus 16.7 degree. So you get an equation like this. Now from this, we are getting an equation of 1.905 R1. Now after solving this, we get R1 is equal to 927.3 newton, and from this equation we get R2 is equal to 1977 newton. Now I am repeating this again, since the free body diagram is very very important for resolving the forces horizontally as well as vertically. So you have three forces here, the self weight of 1500 newton, then you have the resultant reaction R1, you have the resultant reaction R2. So this R1 is nothing but the resultant of N1 and F1. Similarly, this R2 is nothing but the resultant of N2 and F2. So here the frictional force is acting in the downward direction since the block is moving in the upward direction. And here in the case of F2, it is moving or it is acting in this direction. And now I am drawing a horizontal line here. I am drawing a vertical line here. Now the angle of the wedge is 10 degree, that is known. Therefore, this angle will also be equal to 10 degree. And since this normal reaction is perpendicular to the surface AB, since this is 10, this will be equal to 80. And since this and this are perpendicular to each other, if this is 80, this will be equal to 10. Therefore, this R2 is making an angle of 5 plus 10 degrees with respect to vertical. Now, we are resolving the forces horizontally as well as vertically. So, when you resolve the forces horizontally, we get an equation like this. Similarly, when you resolve the forces vertically, we get an equation like this. From this, we get R1. Now after substituting the value of R1 here, we get R2 as 1977 newton. Now coming to the free body diagram of the wedge. So here you can see the frictional force F2, which is acting from A to B. You have the applied force P, and here you have the frictional force F3, which is acting in this direction since the applied force is in this direction. And other than the frictional forces on the applied force, you have the resultant reactions R2 and R3. So R2 is nothing but the resultant of F2 and N2, and R3 is the resultant of N3 and F3. So here you can see phi is nothing but the angle of friction which the resultant reaction makes with the normal reaction. And here also you can see this phi is nothing but the angle which the resultant reaction R2 makes with the normal reaction. Now I am drawing a horizontal line here and drawing a vertical line here. Now this, since this angle is 10 degree, this will also be equal to 10 degree. And since this and this are perpendicular to each other, this angle will be 90 minus 10, therefore it will be 80 degree. And since this surface and the normal reaction are perpendicular to each other, since this is 80, that small angle will be equal to 10 degree. Therefore, this R2 makes an angle of 5 plus 10 degree with respect to vertical. Now we are resolving the forces vertically as well as horizontally, similar to the previous case, that is the free body diagram of the block. So when you resolve the forces vertically, here we get R3 cos phi, that is cos phi is 16.7 degrees, therefore R3 cos 16.7 degrees. Now coming to this force R2, it makes an angle of 5 plus 10 degree with respect to vertical, therefore cos 10 plus 16.7 degrees. So when you simplify this, you get R3 is equal to cos 16.7 is equal to R2 cos 26.7. So after simplification, we get R3 is equal to 1844 Newton. Similarly, when you resolve the forces horizontally, we get, so you have the force P. So P is equal to R2. So R2 sin 5 plus 10. Similarly, plus R3 sin 16.7 degrees. So from this, we get P value as 1418.3 Newton. Now coming to the problem number 2. So here also you have a wedge. The angle of inclination here with respect to horizontal is given as 15 degree. And you have a body of weight 1000 Newton. So the angle of friction is given, it is 14 degree. And you have to find the force P required, which should be applied to the wedge. So you have to find the value of the P. So it is similar to the previous problem only. Now let us consider the free body diagram of the body. So this is the body shown here. So you have the self weight, or the weight of the block, 1000 Newton, which is acting in the downward direction. So since this block is resting on a horizontal surface, so you have the normal reaction N1, and you have the frictional force F1, which is acting in this direction. Since the block, due to this wedge, the block will move upward. Therefore, your frictional force will be acting in this direction. And this R1 is nothing but the resultant of the normal reaction N1 and F1, which is making an angle of phi, that is 14 degree with respect to the normal reaction. Now coming here at this contact surface, so you have the normal reaction N2, which is shown as pink dotted line, and you have the frictional force, so which is shown here. So this is the frictional force which is acting in this direction. So this is the frictional force, and this R2 is nothing but the resultant of N2 and this F2. So this R2 is making an angle of phi, that is 14 degree with respect to N2. Now I am drawing a horizontal line here and I am drawing a vertical line here. And since this is 15 degree, that is angle of wedge is 15 degree, this will be also equal to 15 degrees. So now if this is 15, then you take here the normal reaction is acting perpendicular to this surface. Therefore, if this is 15 degree, then this angle will be equal to 75 degrees. And if this is 75, since this line and this line are perpendicular, this angle will be equal to 15 degrees. Now with this, we are resolving the forces horizontally as well as vertically. So when you resolve the forces horizontally, so you get R1 sine 14 degree. Similarly, coming to R2, if you resolve it horizontally, so you get R2 cos 15 plus 14 degree. So from this we get a relationship between R2 and R1. So we get R1 is equal to 3.616 R2. Similarly, when you resolve the forces vertically, so you have a vertical force of 1000, then you have the vertical component of R1, you have the vertical component of R2. So when you resolve the forces vertically, you get an equation like this. After substituting R1 is equal to 3.616 R2, we get R2 is equal to 330.6 Newton. Now, coming to the free body diagram of the wedge. So now here you have the applied force P like this. Therefore, you have the frictional force F3 which is acting in this direction. And you have the normal reaction N3 which is acting perpendicular to the wall. And R3 is the resultant of N3 and F3. So this R3 is making an angle of 14 degree with the normal reaction. And similarly here at the contact surface, that is between the wedge and the block. So you have the frictional force which is acting in this direction. And you have the normal reaction which is acting perpendicular to the contact surface. So N2 is shown in pink color dotted line. And R2 is nothing but the resultant between F2 and N2, which makes an angle of 14 degree with N2. Now, here also I am drawing a horizontal line here and a vertical line here. And now you can see here, since this angle is 15 degree, so the angle which this inclined line makes with a vertical is also 15 degree. So if this is 15 degree, then the angle between the normal reaction and this vertical line will be equal to 75 degree, since this inclined surface and the normal reaction are perpendicular to one another. So this is 15, so this will be 75. And since this and this are perpendicular to each other, so since this is 75, the small angle will be equal to 15 degree. Therefore, when you resolve the forces horizontally, so you have R3, so R3 cos 14 degree. Similarly, coming to R2, so this R2 cos, so the angle is with respect to horizontal, R2 is making an angle of 14 plus 15. Therefore, it is R2 cos 14 plus 15 degree. So from this, we get, and after substituting of R2, we get R3 is equal to 297.9. Newton. Similarly, when you resolve the forces vertically, so vertically you can have three forces, that is P, vertical component of R3 and vertical component of R2. So we get this equation when you resolve the forces vertically. So P is equal to R3 sin 14 plus R2 sin 14 plus 15. So after simplification, since we know already R2 and R3, after substituting the values of R2 and R3, we can get a value of P as 232.3 Newton. So far we have seen the principles of wedge friction, and also we have seen some two problems on the wedge friction. Now let us see another interesting application of friction, which is wheel friction, which is also called as rolling friction or the rolling resistance. So as we know, when a body rolls over another body, so there also you have some frictional force developed. So that type of frictional force is called as rolling friction. Now, you can see the diagram here. So you have a wheel which is rolling on the surface. And since this wheel rolls on this horizontal surface, some amount of resistance will be developed in the direction opposite to the motion. And here, you can see here, W is nothing but the weight of the body. So W. And here, this P is nothing but the force which is responsible for the motion of this body. And this body rolls on this horizontal surface, so some amount of resistance will be developed in a direction opposite to the direction of the motion. So this resistance is normally developed because of the small deformation which is occurring on the surface because of the rolling body. So as the rolling body moves on this horizontal surface, so some amount of deformation will be developed on this horizontal surface, so which is shown here. So this BC is nothing but the deformation which is created on the horizontal surface because of the rolling body. So the resistance will develop because of the deformation which is created on the horizontal surface by the rolling body. Now this resistance is marked as R here. So this is called as rolling resistance. Now, if you see this particular system, you have only three forces acting on the system. You have the applied force, that is P, you have the weight of the body, and you have the rolling resistance R. So this rolling resistance will be developed at a distance A from the center of the body. Now, since you have only three forces acting on the system, for the equilibrium of the system, all the three forces or the line of action of the three forces must meet at the common point O. So, and also this rolling resistance developed, that this R, it helps to roll the body without any slipping or turning of the body. So here, once again I am repeating, this P is the force applied and W is the weight of the body, and this BC is nothing but a small deformation delta, which is created on the horizontal surface because of the rolling body, and this R is nothing but the rolling resistance, which is developed in a direction opposite to the motion of the body. So this rolling resistance is responsible or it will help the body to prevent any slipping or turning of the body. Now, so as I said earlier, since we have three forces, so the line of action of these three forces should meet at a common point O. Now we are taking moment of all these forces about the point A, that is summation MEA is equal to 0. And here, since this BC is the deformation, is delta, it's very small. So we are neglecting this and we are making this OB. OB is equal to the radius. Since this BC is very small, we are ignoring that. And we are taking that OB as equal to the radius of the wheel. And we are taking moment of all the forces about the point A. So when you take moment of all the forces about the point A, now you start with P. So P into R, P into R. So you are taking moment about A. In fact, it is P into OB. So since BC is very small, we are taking OB is equal to R. Therefore, P into R. So that is P into R is equal to then W. You have another force W. So W into A. So minus W into A. Therefore, when you bring that to other side, we get P into R is equal to W into A. And this A, so we get P is equal to WA by R. And this A is nothing but the horizontal distance of point of resistance measured from the center of the wheel. So this is the center of the wheel. So this A is nothing but the distance measured from the center of the wheel to the point of resistance, that is point A. So this A is nothing but the horizontal distance. So this A is called as coefficient of rolling resistance. Normally, coefficients, they don't have any units. It is usually a dimensionless quantity. But here, the A is measured in terms of millimeter. And if this R is acting at an angle of alpha with the horizontal, so this resistance is developed at an angle of alpha with the horizontal. So the horizontal component of this resistance, that is R cos alpha, it is called as rolling resistance. Now, you take the case where the wheel rolls in a horizontal or in an inclined plane like this. So you have a wheel, the weight of the wheel is W, the weight of the body is W, and this theta is nothing but the angle of inclined surface with respect to horizontal. Therefore, you can resolve this W into two components, that is W cos theta and W sin theta. And here, this is the rolling resistance developed, which again makes an angle of alpha with respect to inclined surface. So this again, this A is nothing but the distance between the center of the wheel and the point at which the resistance is developed. Again, we are taking moment of all the forces about the point A. So you get W cos theta into A. W cos theta, we are taking moment about this point A. Therefore, W cos theta into A. Similarly, you have sine theta. So minus W sine theta into R is equal to 0. From this, we get the coefficient of rolling resistances, W sin theta R divided by W cos theta. So now we have simple problems on this rolling resistance. So you have the problem 1, which is determine the horizontal force required to move a 2750 kg automobile along a horizontal road at a constant speed. The diameter of each tire is 1250 mm. Assume the coefficient of rolling resistance is 3 mm. Neglect all forms of friction except rolling resistance. Now, the given data here is, the mass is given 2750 kg. So you have to find the horizontal force required in order to move a automobile weighing 2750 kg. So mass is 2750 kg, you have to convert that into a weight. So W is equal to M into G. So 2750 into 9.81, you get 26,977.5 newton. And the diameter of the tire is 1250 mm. Diameter is given. And the coefficient of rolling resistance is given. That is small a is given, just 3 mm. So find the horizontal force. So we have this equation P is equal to WA by R. After substituting the known values, we get the horizontal force required as 129.5 newton. So this is very simple problem. And again, the second problem, you have a wheel 250 mm diameter, carries a load of 10 kN. If a horizontal force of 100 N is necessary to move it over a level surface, determine the coefficient of rolling resistance. That is, you have to find small a. So we know that P is equal to WA by R. Therefore, A is equal to PR by W. So here P is the horizontal force, it is given 100 N. And the radius, so diameter is given, you can find the radius, that is 125, and divided by W. So W is nothing but 10 kN. You are converting that into Newton. So from that, we get the coefficient of rolling resistance is 1.25 mm. So the problems in rolling resistance is very, very simple. So you have a simple equation, it is P equal to WA by R. So from that equation, you have to get the unknowns in the problem. So you have to only see whether the body is rolling on a horizontal plane or an inclined plane. So depending on that, you have to use the appropriate equation to find the unknowns. So far we have discussed about principles of wedge friction as well as principles of wheel friction or rolling resistance. So we have seen some of the problems also. And for this presentation or lecture, I have referred a textbook of engineering mechanics by R.S. Kurmi, which is published by S. Chandan Company Limited. Thank you.